Hi, we're going to be presenting about reimagining study abroad as a curricular tool for decolonizing global health. One's destination is never a place, but a new way of seeing things. And we also hope that this is a new way of seeing things and we can learn from this.
Hi, I'm Steve Hawks.
And I'm Jenna Hawks.
And we are planning a study abroad program to Ecuador in May of 2023. And we're exploring this topic because we want to see things in a new way and design hopefully a better study abroad program. If global health is to be based on principles of equity, we must confront the historical legacies of colonialism that continue to perpetuate imbalanced power dynamics and inform attitudes and perspectives in our global health partnerships and educational programs. We need to address our collective ignorance of these legacies and their impacts on our behaviors and educational practices. The continuing growth in global health education necessitates fresh evaluation of these power dynamics. This is a quote from an article that really sets the stage. Decolonizing global health is not a new concept, but it's one that is new to me, at least as far as designing study abroad programs goes. And so I think it's a fruitful area to explore study abroad programs from. And so our goal for participants in this session is that you will learn to describe the aims of decolonizing global health, assess curricular components of applied practice experiences in global settings, specifically study abroad experiences, for potential contributions to the aims of decolonizing global health, and then design global applied practice experiences that contribute to the aims of decolonizing global health.
So speaking of global health and education, ours is a discipline that holds within itself a deep contradiction. Global health was birthed in supremacy, but its mission is to reduce or eliminate inequities globally. And colonized global health can be a difficult concept to fully understand and grasp, and it just perpetuates from the very history of colonial spread. And so just for some clarifying background, during colonial expansion, many locals were exploited for their resources and labor, and they had little to no consideration for the well-being of the locals. And the early branches of medicine were more concerned with pathogenic effects on local labor than they were for the well-being of those locals. So any help that was given was perceived as an investment for greater labor profit later on. This in turn evolved into a savior thinking, and that is where colonial power is saving vulnerable populations that can't and won't save themselves. Unfortunately, though, these colonized perceptions often contain underlying racist tendencies and beliefs, as it was being observed that local populations and transplants differed in disease susceptibility. The colonizers found that locals were often wrong or backward in their thinking, and they needed their guidance or help and the civilization from Europe influence. And today, that colonial assumptions and practices are still pertinent, but may be unconsciously observed in our behaviors. Health practices were built on structures in favor of colonizers, and that any autonomous thinking in contradiction to their own was due to the local populations being perceived as ignorant, reckless, or just not as knowing as colonial power was. And these attitudes have had lasting influence on global health and authority. For example, international care is referenced by former colonial powers and countries with large economic or political influence. And the results is that these low and middle income countries are being marginalized while high income countries are gaining. At the time of writing, young, healthy people in upper, middle, and high income countries are being de facto prioritized for COVID-19 vaccination above elderly, vulnerable people and health workers in low-income and lower-middle-income countries. This is a historic failure of the global health endeavor, or perhaps more accurately, of the global economic order in which it is embedded. And to fully get a broader understanding of decolonizing global health, we performed a scoping review and the search methodology, including using EBSCO's host search databases listed here, using key search words of global health, decolonization or decolonizing, as well as other filters, including publication years of between 2012 and 2022, having a full text and for it to be peer reviewed. And our article selection went as follow. Our database search came up with 65 results. Once duplicates were removed, we had 32 articles. And once we went through article screening and eligibility, we were able to include 13 articles in our scoping review. Now, the screening and eligibility process included accepting theory and practice-based research articles, and then we excluded letters or commentaries and correspondences and editorials. Contributions to colonize global health include structural injustice, and we see throughout history and even today that structural injustices contribute to the controlment of procedures among individuals who are in low to middle income countries brought about by the high income classes. For example, this could look like forced displacement, unnecessary and dangerous procedures, and even the use of drugs with harmful side effects. Health inequity is also a determinant with underlying structural marginalization. The health opportunities are disproportionate, and the distribution of resources among population groups are often affected by race and ethnicity, but also through income and other unnecessary categorization of people. An outcome example is that there are observable higher disease prevalences in these populations. Structural violence goes hand in hand with health inequity. That is that the structures themselves are built in a way that contributes to the harm of a group of people and prevents those individuals from getting a basic health the same way that others would be getting that same service. And lastly, we mentioned unbalanced research, and which looks like little to no author credit with the affiliated country. For an illustrative example, analysis done on collaborative health research in Africa showed that approximately only half gave primary credit to African researchers. Even more noteworthy, 13.5% of papers had no authors from or affiliated from the research-focused country at all. Unfortunately, this means that any recognition from authorship and or funding goes towards the colonialized powers opposed to the institutions who provided materials and collaborations or intellectual input. So for the aims to decolonize global health, we talk a lot about inequity throughout our whole entire process of what we've talked about so far. So in decolonizing it, the goal is to secure equity among high-income countries and low- to middle-income countries, no matter their resources. We aim to value local knowledge and integrate this and local value systems to benefit the public as a whole and to break down the hierarchy of knowledge that exists. We address underlying racism by concentrating on the structural factors that make individuals susceptible to these, opposed to the racist and colonial thoughts that exist and that drive health approaches. We build lasting partnerships, which accompanies valuing local knowledge. In building partnerships, it's also important to collaborate with equal authority, knowledge, and input. And then we transform communities and we transform learning for students. And we do this by investing in health systems that address the needs of the most vulnerable and use transformational learning to develop global citizens. Ultimately, the decolonization of global health seeks to get rid of and no longer use structures that exploit and deprive local communities. And here's just a broad overview of how we can move from a colonial thinking to decolonizing thinking and decolonize global health. by continuing economic and social development, by building and moving towards multipolar global health governance, and by building global consensus to remove colonial remnants.
Thank you, Jenna. So the barriers to decolonizing global health, there's a lot that we could talk about. The colonial legacy is one that is so embedded that we don't really think about it. Our relationships with our global partners, our attitudes towards their systems, their understandings, and the way we've been very dismissive of those things is an implicit bias. And so it's been difficult to even put the colonial legacy on the table and understand it for what it is so that we can then deal with it. Inclusiveness of groups, giving a voice to those that are most vulnerable and those that are impacted by what we do. In our case, educational programs that take our students to foreign countries, how does that impact those groups, and do they have a say in what we're doing and why we're there and what we're trying to accomplish, and how do they benefit? Adequate needs assessments, including larger groups of stakeholders, not just us and our students, but people on the ground in the countries that we visit, and what are their needs? What do they want to see happen out of an educational partnership? Community immersion is something that study abroad can be very good at, minimizing, in this case, power differentials through deep community immersion that gives us a chance to more fully understand cultural nuances in other communities. Ethical dilemmas, putting them on the table, understanding them, and then having foreign and local partners develop a moral framework for developing, for viewing and understanding those dilemmas. And then global health education can be a key to decolonizing global health, and study abroad just might be a great way to begin that process. At its worst, study abroad can be a form of feel-good tourism where we just think primarily about giving our students a great experience, which is not without benefit to them, but it's not necessarily worthwhile in and of itself. So on the left-hand column, in dark blue, current geopolitical and pandemic crises, populism in many countries creates skepticism regarding internationalization. So there's already a tension about what we're doing. Nationalistic agendas diminish global concerns. Travel restrictions, and certainly with the pandemic, we saw study abroad, and in my case, halted for 2 years. And just trying to get back into it going into this next year. And yet COVID is certainly not over with, so we still have challenges. International students and scholars have been hampered in studies because of restrictions. And the importance of global engagement and internationalization is certainly questioned in many areas. So study abroad best practices on the right-hand side. Study abroad, when done, at the highest levels, has been shown conclusively to increase intercultural competence, feelings of global citizenship, personal development skills, deep engagement with diverse communities, understanding of local knowledge, maximizing participatory experiential learning, engaging in guided critical thinking, self-reflection, sharing experiences and transformative outcomes after the study abroad experience that have been realized through deep self-reflection. And so transformative, the next column over, transformative learning theory is one process for guiding those best practices. And I'm not going to go through each step of that, but also there was a recent university declaration for global engagement. And many universities, many academic institutions signed on to that agreement. And the goals of that, or the actions recommended by that University Declaration for Global Engagement, are to develop global competence and engagement skills, increase student understanding of global challenges, increase student mobility to experience directly global realities, enhance cross-border knowledge and information sharing, and then post-study abroad, communicate about progress of the importance of global engagement efforts. So all of those things tied together, that can be very beneficial. The one drawback when we think about decolonizing global health is that it fails in any of these areas to really go beyond what it's doing for the student to what it should be doing for the partners and the communities that we're engaged with. And so I think that's the next step of evolution that needs to take place with study abroad. Deep reform in global health education will require shifts in leadership, priority setting, knowledge and cognitive paradigms, power dynamics, financial arrangements, all of which to an extent can be driven by curricular innovation. And study abroad is a prime candidate for that type of innovation because study abroad programs should and can be of primary benefit to local communities and populations, not just to the participating students, be planned and co-designed with local partners, involve appropriate compensation to those partners for services rendered, provide extensive collaboration and interaction with local practitioners and our students in a way that's mutually beneficial, and lead to shared credit with local partners for any and all outcomes that the engagement produces. A couple of rubrics. This one is from the American Association of Colleges and Universities, from the value group, the Global Learning Value rubric, Valid Assessment of Learning in Undergraduate Education. There's more here than we want to cover in this presentation, but do want to note that this kind of rubric is available. It's very well thought through. It addresses global self-awareness, perspective taking, cultural diversity, personal and social responsibility, understanding global systems. All of those things play really well into what we're talking about in terms of the innovation of study abroad curricula. And so we can take that through, you know, from marginal to exceptional along all those categories, a great way to think about how we design our programs. A second rubric that's somewhat similar, the Fair Trade Learning rubric. Again, the indicators are developing common purposes, host community program leadership. So giving some of the leadership to the host community, the global partners, the local partners that we're dealing with. Always considering the rights of the most vulnerable and giving that group a voice, making them a prominent stakeholder that has input into what we're doing. Theory of change, again, a theoretical model that can not only across the bottom benefit students, which has been our focus, but it should also be employed to benefit communities. So again, from entry to intermediate to advanced to ideal, another really good rubric for thinking through what we want to accomplish with study abroad innovation and how we want to think about how we want to measure how successful we are. Core principles are a knowledge base that's not only informed by Western biomedicine, but that's also informed by local expertise and lived experience. A more profound sense of universalism that treats all persons as being morally equal with the right to escape preventable illness, unnecessary afflictions, and premature mortality. And then purpose very intentionally and consciously aligns the aims of study abroad with the aims of decolonizing global health in a way that promotes far higher levels of equitable collaboration between academics and between our local partners and community members without jeopardizing the goals of global health. So this is going to require deep reflection. Rubrics can help us do that. Very intentional planning, a lot of pre-planning and a lot of communication. We're almost a year out, less than a year out from our study abroad in Ecuador, but we've already had some very meaningful interactions and engagements with the Directorate of Health that we will be working with, and what do they want to see happen? What are their goals? What are the populations that they interact with? And so we're already in the thick of trying to do meaningful planning that will result in action of holding hands with our partners, trying to be very thoughtful about what they're looking for, what their needs are, making sure they're compensated, that we're not a burden, that it's mutually beneficial. And it's done in a way that fosters equitable dynamics, transformative learning, and cognitive justice.
So there are some limitations to using scoping review, and that is that scoping reviews are exploratory. They consider a broad research question or questions, and they assess the extent of existing research, but this may be inconclusive or incomplete depending on the research that does exist. And there are a limited number of articles that were identified for review and inclusion. In our case, we only had 13 that were identified. And then there are some research gaps. There is very limited to no understanding of the potential impacts of innovative study abroad programs in achieving the aims of decolonizing global health.
So the next steps for us are to use rubrics, theory, key principles to collaboratively design study abroad programs with our global partners, local community members that align with the aims of decolonizing global health, and then to rigorously evaluate impacts, not only on our students, but on the communities that host us, on the leaders that are in our partner organizations. What are the impacts using robust qualitative and quantitative research methods? Thank you for sharing this presentation with us. Please send any comments our way, steve.hawks, jenna.hawks@usu.edu. And we've also included the references for the articles that came out of our scoping review, and hope this has been beneficial. Thank you.